My name is Tim Corder. I'm with Diversified, and we have Anthony and Tom and Marcus with us from Disguise. Why don't you guys all introduce yourself and your role on the team, and then Marcus, I'll have you kick us off.
Hey, so I'll get started. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Good. Live from London. So my name's Tom Rockhill. I'm Chief Sales Officer at Disguise, looking after the global sales team. And we're excited to talk you through this new, I guess, newish technology of XR. And let the guys introduce themselves. Anthony?
How you doing? I'm Anthony McIntyre, coming live from New York City. I'm Technical Specialist in the East Coast.
And my name is Marcus, and I am coming live from sunny LA, Technical Solutions Specialist for Disguise as well, and with a particular focus on XR, which we're about to dig into today.
So we're very honored and thrilled to be invited to do this this webinar. We're kind of excited to see some of the feedback from the crowd that we have on the call, and keen to show you what we've been up to. So let's get started. Marcus, do you want to get us kicked off?
Sure. So this is what we're going to be talking about today. I'm going to spend an hour or so discussing what XR is and why it is important right now, what XR actually consists of, showing you bits and pieces of the workflow. Then we'll dig into some specific case studies that shows applications of XR, what you can do with it, and how it can be applied right now in the current situation. And then if we have time, we'll also do a demo of the actual workflow that we are proposing. And then we can discuss some next steps after that. We will be, I'm guessing we will be recording this as well. So this can be shared afterwards. So first of all, some of you may or may not already have heard about Disguise, but I'm going to let Tom explain what Disguise actually is.
So some of you may know Disguise, some of you may not. So we are a technology company. We make the software and hardware products that are used for people like yourselves to imagine, create, and then deliver spectacular live visual experiences in many different industries. So from concert touring, which is where we started doing shows for people like U2, to live events, launches, live broadcast shows, award ceremonies, music videos, using a lot of technology to do with augmented reality and real-time content, as well as pre-rendered content, fixed installation, experiential, attractions such as museums, building projections, and really anywhere where someone is trying to tell a story using video, we kind of sit at the heart of that creative and technical process, including in theatre and opera, where we're the backbone of many of the shows in Broadway and the West End in London. So really a platform that's used to, I guess, kind of tell stories using video across all of these different worlds. And in short, you can say that Disguise helps you to imagine, create, and deliver spectacular live visual experiences. So we do that over what we call our live experience platform. And that consists of software parts, so the designer software, which you can download on the website today. And that's really the brains of the operation. That's where all of the clever stuff happens. The hardware, which is kind of the robust, reliable, well-known black boxes that distribute the video to wherever you're programming it to go in the software. And we have many, many integrations. So integrations with third parties and other technologies, which mean that if you're putting on a show or an experience, or you're doing an installation to a house of worship, you can make it look different every single time using those integrations with things like tracking, camera tracking, real-time engines. And we've worked with over 2,000 brands and artists to deliver shows and contents to an audience of billions since we've been doing this for the last 15 years or so. And all of this technology, so we're a technology company, but it's all underpinned by people. So we've got 24-hour worldwide support. We train around 1,000 people a year in person. However, we've just started remote training and in the last 5 weeks since worldwide, one of which is Diversified. So very pleased to be working with those guys on this particular webinar. So we're a global company, and I guess why that's important is so we're headquartered out of London. We have offices in Los Angeles and New York, both of which have support and training staff based locally. So we have a good presence across North America, but we do also have a presence in Spain, China, Hong Kong, and Japan. And I guess the other thing to mention here is we have 24-hour global support. So no matter when you have an issue in the middle of the night, you can phone the support line and somebody will be there to answer. And this kind of workflow that we described, this live experience platform, is being used across all of these different verticals, and we're kind of seeing success in all of these different areas. So in theatre, things like Dear Evan Hansen on Broadway, live events, we've done lots of brand launches, motor shows, that sort of thing, broadcast TV and film, concert touring is where that's kind of disguised as bread and butter. That's what we've been doing for 10, 15 years, and then esports as well is quite a new vertical for us, as well as fixed install, which covers everything from, well, I guess you'd say house of worship, but also attractions and themed entertainment, corporate lobbies, casinos, that sort of thing. So before we kind of talk about XR and what XR is, I guess it's sort of important just to very, very briefly describe the Disguise workflow. So you might think of Disguise as a media server, you might think of it as the designer software, but really it's an end-to-end workflow. So there are six main stages to doing something when you're working inside a Disguise. Number one is concept development. So that's bringing in all of your media, your content, and actually planning it inside of our designer software. Number two is content validation. So that's doing all of your technical setup and validating all of your projectors and LED and making sure the content will look really, really good on the surfaces that you're setting up in 3D. You've got show sequencing. So that's sequencing your video to music or cues. You've got loading, which is loading all of the content onto the actual media servers themselves and prepping for rehearsals. You've got rehearsals where, regardless of what happens in rehearsals, if someone turns up with a USB key 10 minutes before you're due to go on, there's no problem for Disguise. You can have a constant and kind of iterative and responsive workflow all the way to delivery. And then it's showtime. So we've been delivering some of the biggest shows for over a decade now across a multitude of different industries. So the main topic, XR, which is short for extended reality. So what is extended reality? What's it all about? So our term, XR, covers a collection of Disguise workflows focused on camera tracking and real-time content generation. That's the summary. And I guess these workflows can be applied to traditional screens. That's like, backgrounds, LED, projection-based surfaces, can be applied to AR, so that's augmented reality items and computer-generated things that may sit in the foreground or around the presenter or the actor, the talent, whatever. All by combining both of those things. So that's tracked backgrounds as well as augmented reality. We call that mixed reality. And we'll give you some examples a little bit later as to what those things are. Just a fat note as well, VR does not relate to XR in the Disguise workflow. We use VR for pre-visualization, but it doesn't relate to the XR experience here. So why XR now? I think what we've seen over the last couple of years is that XR has gone from this kind of it's kind of like niche and very technologically advanced and innovative technology for gaming and entertainment through to quite a mainstream technology in all sorts of different walks of life. So education, healthcare, retail, business, corporate, design, and hopefully house of worship as soon. And the market for XR is growing very, very quickly. The reason that we think we see that is because XR sits at the juncture of three interesting things that are happening, three interesting technology trends. So those trends are as follows, and I'm sure all of you on this call are witnessing these things as well. So LED is becoming finer pitch and lower cost. So when I say lower cost, I guess what I mean is better value. So for your you're getting more pixels. Quality LED. The second trend is that GPUs are getting faster and faster, so the capacity for real-time processing and real-time graphics is just growing exponentially, and we're seeing, you know, films like The Lion King being a lot of it being shot with real-time technology and not having to go through rendered processes. There's just so much power now in these GPUs. And the third technology trend that we're seeing is that artists are turning to real-time engines for creative potential. So you've got tools like Notch, but also Unity and Unreal, where artists in all walks of life, whether you're in design or you're in shows or you're in theater or you're in broadcast or you're in film, are turning to these creative tools to enable them to create amazing visuals with real-time graphics processing. So a combination of these three things is meaning that the content created in real-time engines is being processed immensely quickly on these GPUs and pushed across incredible high resolution canvases.
And thank you, Tom, for that. So now it's time to dig into some technical details on why should you use extended reality and how do you actually use it? And what is the value of XR? We're all familiar with green screen workflows and what they are and what they do and their common applications. And if you've ever used a green screen or blue screen workflow, you're also accustomed to the problems that they present and the challenges. And although there are plenty of tools out there that will mitigate these problems and help you deal with green screen workflows and create augmented reality experiences and virtual sets, they all require certain compromises in quality or design, system robustness, or presenter engagement, or even time necessary in post-production to get the results. And all of these problems with traditional workflows is what we are attempting to solve with our extended reality workflows. So what is disguise extended reality really? So it's not a product per se. It is a collection of workflows that when combined creates something that is greater than the sum of its parts. And it can consists of these five individual elements that we put together. In-camera screens, camera tracking, generative content, augmented reality, and the power of the existing disguise workflow. So let's dig into those five in detail and see what they actually mean. In-camera screens or green screen replacement means essentially having an LED screen or a couple of LED screens as your background in a studio. So instead of having a green screen or a blue screen, you have LED video screens that act as a background for the presenter or the actors. So what does this give you? Well, first of all, LED screens are emissive light sources. So that means that you get lighting and you get shadows. For real, these are created automatically just by the LED screens being light sources. Reflections, if your talent has glasses or you have reflective props on your stage, they will receive lighting from the screens and create automatic reflections that look very, very realistic because they are real. And this is something that is very difficult to create in a traditional post-production process. There's no keying going on, since what the camera sees is what it captures. It looks at the screens, and that is the final pixel that we refer to. So there's no keying, and therefore there's no green spill either. So there are no fringes on a talent's hair or things like that, that are traditional problems with the green screen workflow. You can, by using this, you can create a huge immersive environment in a very small studio space through something that we refer to as extensions. And this is, in essence, a way of extending the virtual world outside of the bounds of the LED screens. And we'll get back to later on how we exactly are able to do that. One traditional problem with green screen is that the presenter or performer, they do not know where they are because they only see this green world around them. By using extended reality, they can see the world that they are in. They can relate to that world and they can feel immersed in that world, which improves their performance massively. They can use natural eyelines. You can, for example, have a screen inside this virtual environment that the presenter can refer to and point towards and look at. And that means that they see where that screen is and they can automatically look towards it and know exactly where it is in because it's actually there. That obviously then means that there's no need for comfort monitors because for the talent to know where they're supposed to look, they just look in the environment behind them or around them and not at a monitor that is placed somewhere on stage, which creates these unnatural eyelines. The post-production cycle is thus very much reduced, and you can create, you can spend more time making creative visual decisions in the set or in the studio instead of afterwards. So an example of how this can look is this video from the Winter Olympics in 2018, where we had our partner White Light create this LED cube. So everything you see is rendered in real time. So the presenter and Amy here, who is a British snowboarder, she's fresh off her ride, fresh off the slope, going into the studio and talking about her experience and talking about her ride. And she can actually see herself riding here. So if this was a traditional green screen workflow, that would have been very, very difficult for her because she has no media training whatsoever. So, but in this case, she would just walk up on stage and she could see herself immediately on this virtual TV screen in front of her and able to talk about that in a very, very natural and relaxed fashion. So aside from these screens, another element to making this happen is through camera tracking. So in order to make this environment look realistic from the eye of the camera, we need to know where the camera is in 3D space and in relation to where the screens are located. We have built-in support for both optical and mechanical tracking systems, and we have drivers for the most common tracking manufacturers out there. So that's Mosis and Stipe and Encam, OptiTrack and BlackTrax, and whatever else will be the flavor of the month next month. Same thing with mechanical tracking technologies built on encoders. That is something that we've been doing in our live entertainment world for many, many years. So that works really well as well. We also have support for multi-camera workflows. So you're not tied to using a single camera from a single point of view. You can have multiple cameras and you can use your traditional broadcast switching infrastructures to cut between those cameras. One common problem when using tracking systems together is something that we call world alignment. You have multiple different three-dimensional worlds in different systems that all need to be aligned. And this can be very, very time-consuming in a traditional workflow where everything has to be done manually. We have an algorithm in our system that is based on structured lights that can reduce the calibration time to less than 10 minutes for a typical setup. Lens calibration. Typically, if you use a tracking system with a green screen, you need to do a very, very tedious lens calibration process, or you have a lens file coming from the either from the lens manufacturer or from the tracking system manufacturer. And these are all very tedious and time-consuming processes, but we have a lens calibration process that can calibrate your lens and zoom levels in less than 30 minutes. And since we know where the camera is in 3D space, that also means that we can pre-visualize every camera movement and block your shots in the software prior to actually arriving in the studio, which is particularly helpful if you have a temporary setup and you need to know which camera moves you can do, how far away from the stage can you move your camera, how close to the stage can you be, so on and so forth. And those are things that will affect your creative decisions, and being able to know that information ahead of time is very, very helpful and time saving. So let's have a quick look at how this calibration procedure looks like. This is from, I think, IBC in Amsterdam last September. And you see these white dots that appear on the LED screens. We know, or our system knows, the pattern that we are expecting to see. And then we read that back through the camera. And by doing so, we can then figure out exactly where the screens are located in relation to each other and in relation to the camera. And as you can see, it was a very fast process. And that is typically how it looks. You do a couple of those and then you're good to go. Another key element to making this work is something that we refer to as generative content. And another term for generative content is real-time rendered content. And that differs from a traditional content workflow in that your video, quote unquote, is rendered in real time. So you bypass the traditional, for example, Adobe After Effects or Maya workflow where you render out video files. Instead, your content is binary files that are rendered out in real time. So you can imagine them being almost like an instruction set for the graphics engine instead of a video file that can just be played back and forth. So this enables you to build a three-dimensional world for your environment and constantly create different content for the same space. You can make one physical studio setup, but use it for multiple different purposes. The scene is rendered from the camera viewpoint. So as we can see on the image here to the left, it looks kind of warped and strange from the point of view of the audience around it. But from the point of view of the camera, the perspective is perfectly correct. And this enables us to then create a sense of false depth or false 3D in a scene, because the camera is essentially looking into a virtual environment and the camera believes that it's looking into this 3D space instead of just looking at two-dimensional LED surfaces. We have integrated workflows for the most popular real-time engines on the market today. So that is Notch, Unity, and Unreal. So no matter what your tradition, what your workflow is today, the Disguise system can support that. And this then enables you to explore these 3D worlds as required by production. You don't have to have any forced shots or locked off cameras, because you have a complete flexibility in roaming around in this world, even outside of the actual LED screens where we have these set extensions that we mentioned earlier. And this then enables you to make creative decisions regarding the environment live without going back and re-rendering content. You can make changes to the environment in real time, for example, changing lighting conditions or changing the colors of the walls, or essentially anything that anything that has been created inside this environment can also be changed in real time. So you can have an environment that is looking through a window out on a mountain scene, and you can change the time of day outside in real time, going from sunset to from dusk to dawn, and so on and so forth. The fourth element is augmented reality. Augmented reality is everything that happens in the foreground of the 3D scene. So if we look at this image to the left, this is from a Korean boy band called BTS. And you can see that the singer here is looking up towards a text that we have here saying London. And this text here doesn't actually exist on stage. Obviously, it's very difficult to just float letters like this in nothingness. So this is just being augmented onto the outgoing broadcast feed. That's what we refer to as augmented reality. And this then enables you to create depth in the outgoing scene. So you can have virtual elements being brought in front of the performers, you can have performers walk around these elements, because we can know where they are in 3D space. Key to making this look realistic is for the color to be the same, the color between the foreground and the background. And this is something that we also do as part of our calibration workflow, where we can tune the colors of the LED screens to match that of your reference material. You can also use conventional key and fill workflows to easily integrate into your existing broadcast infrastructure. And you can also composite elements in the 3D space inside the Disguise platform. So you can have multiple layers of content on multiple layers in your 3D space. And that's kind of what I referred to earlier, where you can have a performer walk around an augmented object, because we know where both the talent and the augmented object exist in 3D space. And here's a few examples. This is from a broadcast done together with Malf Media. And you can see on the right-hand side is the AR graphics and tracking data. And on the left-hand side is the actual outgoing broadcast feed. This is from the Pakistani Super League, where most of these graphics were augmented out on the outgoing broadcast feed. So these are all planes that doesn't really exist. They only exist and they're only visible on the outgoing broadcast feed here. And this was one of the biggest ones that has ever been created, running on two of our Disguise GX2 servers and broadcast over 50 million viewers. And the key to this was being able to accurately and fast calibrate where the screens were between for every rehearsal, which happened several times a day. So this then all is tied into the traditional or the power of the Disguise workflow, which gives you all the benefits of working in that environment with 3D simulation, VR pre-visualization, multiple user editing, and a host of other features. So you can use one single environment, one creative environment for both your LED screen and your augmented reality objects, which then combines to create the mixed reality. And you can also create or control lighting from the Disguise workflow to bring in another element to this immersive world. So that gives you one platform for visualization, pre-programming, and delivery with built-in VR simulation of all production elements. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is what Disguise extended reality is. In-camera screens, camera tracking, generative content, augmented reality, and the power of the Disguise workflow. And with that, I will hand the virtual microphone over to Tom.
Hi, everyone. So let's look at a few examples then of how XR has been used in to use it in your own setups. Oh, can you hear me okay? Am I back? All right. So this is an example from 2018. What you can see here is Andy standing on LED floor and LED walls. The camera is tracked using MOSIS. The tracking data is taken inside Disguise, where on Notch, inside of Notch, there is a virtual environment running, which you can see. And the camera input is taken as a render input, and the correct pixels to show the correct perspective behind the camera are pushed to the LED wall and floors behind Andy. So there is a blend point there about where those three screens are on the right hand side, where the real physical LED finishes and the virtual world starts, but everything is tracked and mapped inside of the sky, so you would never know that there was a blend there. So you can place a performer or a presenter or you know, anybody, I guess, inside of this LED environment, which could be quite small. It could be just a 3 meters cubed, and you can put them absolutely anywhere, any virtual environment that you can imagine. But the good thing is that you don't need to be a trained performer to stand in that environment. It's not green screen, so you can see everything that's happening around. It's been used in broadcast as well, XR. You can see for the FIFA Football World Cup, the Soccer World Cup. On the left and right-hand sides, so you've got a window behind the presenters. On the left and right-hand side, you can see LED walls. They are tracked inside a Disguise. And you can see the perspective and the illusion of a large window behind, with everything mapped inside of our products. White Light, who did this installation, are not the only people to have done a broadcast installation with XR. This is quite a nice and simple example. So you've got a presenter desk, you've got content running behind on LED in Notch, and you've got a tracked camera. So when the camera moves towards the content changes shape and gives the illusion of depth and perspective, as you can see when the camera sweeps in here. That's quite a simple technique. XR has also been used in esports. You can see here in augmented reality in the foreground, there are elements of the gameplay, which is being talked about here in this esports event. The presenter's obviously sitting at a desk in a small LED screen, but they've been placed inside a virtual environment, which is running inside the game. And then they're able to drop these augmented reality elements in the foreground, which the camera can move around, even though they're not actually there. And so this is a music video by Meptic in North America. So they were working on this with a couple of GX2Cs, Disguise products, and putting Flurry inside of a kind of psychedelic environment. So all of the graphics are swirling around her, and they wanted to capture her real emotion of seeing all these swirling graphics and images floating around her, as well as all of the reflections and the lighting information coming on her face. It eliminated the need for post-production, having to go and do all that stuff in post-production, thanks to capturing it all in camera. And the BTS example that Marcus talked about. So I like this example for House of Worship. The audience themselves don't see the augmented reality graphics around the performers, but if you're watching the IMAG screens either side, or you're watching a live broadcast, you can see those graphics. So for many of the people inside the stadium who don't experience, they're not close enough to the performers to actually experience the performers up close, and they're watching the IMAG screen performance, they can see all of the augmented reality hearts and particles and everything floating around the performers, and it gives them an enhanced experience of actually being at the concert itself. This is a really nice example from a show in the UK, the Brit Awards, a very big music concert award ceremony. This is a guy called Dave, a performer called Dave. There is one single projector output. XR does not need to be complicated. So there's a one single projector output down onto the piano, and all of the content is created inside of Notch and tracked to the perspective of the moving camera. And of course, it gives this amazing effect of looking like the piano has a is essentially like a tunnel with lots of stuff happening inside of it. So this was quite a poignant performance and sort of very impactful, made the front page news in the UK. You're on mute there, Marcus. You're going to talk about this one. So this is Halsey on the Ellen Show.
Right. Yes. Sorry about that. So this was this is a programmer by name Halsey, and this was produced by a partner of ours called All of It Now from San Francisco. So this was a live broadcast on the Ellen Show, and you can see now that they are inside this augmented reality world, and they're exploring the what you can do with the camera there. Jumping on to the next one, which is Netflix. We helped out on the Night Flyers show, which is available on Netflix for streaming right now. And this was actually not a XR workflow as we see it. This was using traditional 2D content in multiple layers, but still tracked with a camera. And this goes to show that you can create some very powerful and realistic looking immersive experiences, actually without using real-time rendered content. So as you can see in this case, there's a spaceship or some kind of structure moving in front of a static background. And by tracking the camera and moving these elements in 3D space, we can create a very realistic looking experiment. This here is from the latest Star Wars movie. So here we have one of our partners, Lux Machina. We use disguise to supply a rear projection to the backdrop of the studio, enabling very accurate lineups of graphics in shot and realistic looking lighting and on actors. And this created a very, very realistic acting performance as these actors were sitting inside the spaceship. As you can see, it's also on actuators, so it's moving around as they are sort of traveling in hyperspace. And a fun anecdote here is that the actors, with the first time they walked into this environment, they actually didn't know what to expect. That they thought that this background that they were seeing was going to be static. But as soon as they started playing and the spaceship started moving, they all reacted as if they were on inside an amusement park. And that obviously created very, very realistic performances. So what can you do today? This, I think, is a very good example of how you don't actually have to break the bank to do XR. You can have a relatively small LED setup and a locked off camera, so no camera tracking system in this case. And it still creates this very realistic and immersive illusion for the person on stage. This is another example from our partner Faber in the Netherlands, where they retrofitted one of their green screen rooms with an LED setup and have created this hybrid room where they can do both green screen, if that is desirable by the client, and extended reality setups with the LED on a very, very fast turnaround.
This is actually a really nice example of the House of Worship, the Methodist Church in London in the UK. So they used White Light, one of our systems integrators in the UK, built this LED cubes, that's LED floor, LED walls. And during the COVID-19 crisis, they were unable to reach their congregation and to have their services every Sunday. And so the vicar here was able to come actually on the stage without contacting any other humans, give his entire sermon, have other people zooming in on the wall, as you can see. And so it was an engaging kind of interactive experience, and not come into contact with anybody else and then leave the studio. Everything's controlled by remote cameras. But created the illusion of him being inside the church, which they've done with photography from earlier, and sort of created this immersive, engaging remote space. This is a good example of one of our, and we'll probably skip through this one fairly quickly, but another partner of ours, Bright, in Germany, creating an immersive space. So this is really just to kind of show you some of the things that have been done and kind of fill your head with ideas of what's possible with this XR feature set. Everything from Star Wars to these kind of immersive. Opportunity or Unreal, and you've got LED tracking, all of this stuff, quite straightforward. I think let's skip this one, Marcus. You're on mute there, Marcus. So you're going to give us a quick product demo and a quick view of the interface?
Yes, I'm going to give you a quick demonstration of a XR of the Disguise XR workflows, and we'll dig into that.
And so, as we talked about earlier, everything everything in Disguise exists and starts in the software. The software is really the brains of the operation. So you can download that for free, as we said, on our website, and start playing. If you want access to this special XR build, then please contact us. I hope we can do a joint follow up with Diversified after this to everybody who's attended, and please get in contact with us, and we will provide that to you. Marcus is going to show you the user interface very quickly and give you an idea of how you can set things up for XR in the 3D space.
Indeed. I am starting our software as we speak. So I'm going to just stop sharing my screen, then we'll jump over to the software real quick.
And I think the thing with XR is it's, as I said, it's everything from the most, from Star Wars, from the most high profile or the most complex use cases you can possibly imagine, with multiple LED surfaces and tracking and high resolution photorealistic environments. But it can just be a background that is camera tracked perspective, and given the illusion of perspective. It can be sort of a very basic, small setup, which gives quite a nice immersive feel to something that's happening, live or on stage, as well as the augmented reality graphics. So, it doesn't even have to be a background. It can just be using AR items in the foreground and around the performers, like the BTS on the Korean pop band that we saw with the augmented reality hearts hanging around them. You can create those effects really easily. And actually, in the latest version of the Disguise software, you can, with an HTC Vive, you can actually just bring 3D models in and track that around the environment. So you can actually do stuff very, very quickly in Disguise and actually bring AR things in for people to use.
So I'm going to attempt to reshare my screen here. And and I hope that is it, right? Do you see my screen now?
Yes, we do.
Perfect. So for those of you who have not seen the Disguise workflow or the Disguise software before, this is it. And it's a fully 3D video production platform that allows you to pre-visualize all your screens, all your content, and program your shows and control your media servers in one single platform. So what we're looking at here is a typical, what we refer to as an XR setup. We have two LED screens and an LED floor. And if we look into each one of these, we can see that they have a size in meters, and they have a resolution. And knowing all that information about the screens allows us to then do the calibration that we mentioned earlier. Up here, I have two cameras. I have a virtual camera that I refer to as my source cam, and I have my main camera here. And for all intents and purposes, in a real world scenario, you would only have one camera. and it would have a tracking source attached to it. The tracking source is the tracking system that is sending real-time positional data into the disguise system, telling the system where the camera is. So as I move this camera around here, you can see that this camera that exists in 3D space is actually physically moving around. So this is exactly what it would look like if we had an actual tracking system tracking the actual movements of the camera. So if we jump into our next section here, we have an augmented reality setup. And as you can see, the screens now turn black because there's nothing on the screens. But if we look up here on our main cam, we have all of a sudden we have a Formula One car existing in 3D space. So as I now move my camera around, you can see that this Formula One car only exists in the viewpoint of the camera. So what I can do with that is I can change the position and the rotation of this object without affecting anything else in the scene. So I can choose from which angle I want to view this car. If we jump on to the next section here, we have a studio which exists then in mixed reality. So when we talk about mixed reality, this is then a combination of content on video screens and content that is being applied outside these screens. So as you can now see, this broadcast studio is being projected onto these screens from the perspective of this camera. So if I now pretend that I'm standing here on the side of the screen, we can see that the perspective is looking, or the content is looking, very warped from where I as a bystander is standing. But if we look up here to the right, we can see that the content is actually looking correct from the perspective of where the camera is. And as you can also see, there's a slight difference here between what this camera is seeing and what this camera is actually sending out. So if I zoom in, we can see that we're only rendering what the camera is seeing. So this is what we refer to as the camera frustum. And if we zoom out, all of a sudden, the camera is now only seeing the screens and the empty space that exists around the LED screens. But here, we can see that we're actually applying now what we refer to as the set extensions outside of the bounds of the LED screens. This then enables you to have these endless environments that you can roam around in and create very immersive experiences for both the persons on stage and the talent and the audience at home. And that is the short version of the demo.
So I think there's a lot of technical stuff that we can get stuck into, and I think we've kind of touched on some of it. I hope it hasn't been too technical. I hope it's been technical enough. But one of the follow-ups is, if you're interested in these workflows, so if you think, actually, that's something I'd like to try, I'd like to get to grips with, perhaps there's some downtime at the moment, if churches are closed, for example, we'd be happy to sort of get you up to speed and kind of take you through the workflow. So you have two experts here. You've got Marcus and Anthony available for doing that kind of thing. So one of the follow-ups would be, if you are interested, please reach out via the follow-up, and we'll gladly take you through that and show you how to get up to speed with XR.
Yeah, that's it.
There's us.
Anthony, do you have anything to add to the conversation?
Yeah, I would just like to credit Diversified and yourself for bringing this all together and to make this all happen. So looking forward to working. everybody that's associated with this.
Yeah, thanks to Diversified.
Yeah,
thank you so much for attending.
Yep, I would echo thank you to everyone for attending. As you can see, you know, this technology is at the forefront of a lot of emerging spaces. I got to experience this face-to-face last year at the Disguise office in LA, and immediately my mind just started moving of ways that we could utilize these tools in live event spaces to even blend, to blend online audiences with experience in the room, and even look for new ways to allow communicators, especially, to be able to engage with audiences. So I think the most important thing is looking for forward-thinking creatives who are inspired by this technology and will look for ways to, you know, to make application. Obviously the technology is cool, but how it's used is really the most mission critical part of the entire thing.
So to add to that, Tim, as well. So I think that's a really good point. The technology is really cool. It's really advanced, but the application can be very simple. But it's also, you don't need to be a trained performer or presenter to stand in front of that space. You saw the priest in the UK very gladly step into what looked like his church and quite sort of happily give his Sunday address. And so if you stood on that space in LA, you'll know how easy it is to stand there and just start talking to camera. It's quite a natural experience.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
And I think that is something that we're more than happy to provide advice and direction on. If you have creative ideas that you would like to explore, we're more than happy to help facilitate those conversations and make sure that the technology can support you in your creative visions.
Excellent. Thank you guys so much for the presentation, and thank you to everyone for joining us.